So, accounting coach survival tips, Jonathan Ruiz. Thank you so much for giving me good feedbacks with the 7 Habits of Highly Effective Students ebook. So, this is free. You can still sign up and get it on the link below, okay, on this YouTube video, on the description. So, please do so. I will send it to you. This will help you in your journey to become a certified public accountant. Okay, so what is our agenda today? So this is a continuation of financial ratios. Okay, so, but specifically, our learning outcomes will be about activity ratio. Okay, I'm going to discuss it, give you the definition and explanation, and give you the needed formulas. For the problems, you need to get a sample problem and do the calculation by yourself. Always remember, practice makes perfect. Okay, so I will leave you with that. So this video lesson will not include any problems, only explanation and formulas. Okay, so let's move on. So like what I have said, we have major categories of financial ratios. So in the previous video, we recorded liquidity ratio. So this time we have activity ratio, and then we will move to profitability, leverage, and market value. Okay, so this actually financial ratios are very helpful if you are going to analyze the financial statements of a specific company. Okay, so this will help you if you are a customer, then you will know if they can continuously provide value for you. If you are a stakeholder, a shareholder, then you will know if you will get your return. So there are many uses of these financial ratios. This is not only a figure or a number, but it depicts a message, okay? It gives you an explanation of how the company is doing in terms of performance, in terms of liquidity, in terms of their business. Okay, now, what is activity ratio? So activity ratio, actually, it measures, no, how quickly the firm converts two of its major non-cash assets, which means the accounts receivable and inventory. Okay, so remember, this is tied up with liquidity ratio, because the better you manage the liquidity, so the items actually in income statements used here is always the net. So the accounts receivable is relating to your net sales, and then the inventory is relating to your cost of sales. Okay, so there is a relationship in your income statement and balance sheet items. Now, here is the rule. In calculating the ratios, you include both balance sheet and income statement items. But always remember, average balances of balance sheet, okay, instead of the ending balance. An income statement should be annualized if less than a year. Okay, so always remember this rule. Again, average balances. So sometimes students make mistake in this calculation. They know already the formula, but they forgot to do the average. They will just take the ending balance. So it's wrong. Now, what are the activity ratios? We have accounts receivable turnover ratio, day sales in receivables, inventory turnover, day sales in inventory, AP turnover, days purchases in AP, fixed assets turnover ratio, total assets turnover ratio. Okay, financial ratios are always included in the CPAL. So it's very, very important to understand the concept and have an idea on how to apply the formulas. Now, let's move on to accounts receivable turnover ratio. This measures how efficient the firm in collecting its receivables. Sometimes the company will just sell the items and then will forget to collect the receivables. So it's very important because it affects your cash flow. This the average number of times the receivables from sales are collected during the year. So here we need to strictly follow the credit days you are given to your customer. So our formula is net credit sales divided by average accounts receivable. Okay, in terms of examination, you always use the 365 days unless otherwise stated. Okay, Now, day sales in receivables. So this is the number of days the receivable is outstanding or the average collection period. So the formula is days in the year divided by receivable turnover. Okay? Now, again, you need to calculate your average accounts receivable divided by the annual credit sales for the days in the year. Okay? Now, let's move on to inventory turnover. This measures the firm's efficiency in managing its inventory. Okay? Of course, what the business should do or the company should sell their inventories and they should have longer inventories in their warehouse. This is the average number of times the inventory was sold during the year. So our formula, cost of goods sold divided by average inventory. Now, moving on with our day sales in inventory. This is the average number of days the inventory is held before it is sold. Okay, days in the year divided by inventory turnover. Okay, so the inventory turnover is average inventory divided by your cost of goods sold over days in the year. Okay, you can just go back, okay, or screenshot the formulas that I'm giving you. Okay, then we have the operating cycle. Okay, what is the operating cycle? This is the time between the acquisition of inventory and the collection of cash on the sale of the inventory. So, meaning days sales in receivables plus days sale in inventory. Okay, shorter operating cycle, the better. Okay, always remember that. It measures how quick you have collected your cash after the inventory is sold. Okay, then accounts payable turnover. This measures the firm's efficiency in managing its payment to its suppliers. Okay, so credit purchases divided by average accounts payable. Okay, so that means we need also to pay our suppliers on time and follow the credit days given. Now, days purchases in accounts payable. This is the number of days it takes to settle a payable. So our formula, days in the year divided by accounts payable turnover. So how to calculate accounts payable turnover? This is the average accounts payable divided by annual credit purchases divided by days in the year. Okay, the days in the year, like what I have said, 365 days. Now, cash conversion cycle measures the time between payments made to supplier and collections from customers. So it's very simple. After you calculated your operating cycle, less the days purchases in accounts payable. Okay, shorter cash conversion cycle, the better. Okay, because you have only a few days to wait when you receive cash from customer after payment to suppliers. So the cash flow is very, very fast. Okay, the inflows of cash, I mean. Now, fixed assets turnover. This measures how efficiently the company is deploying its investment in fixed assets to generate revenues. So our formula, net sales divided by average PPE or property, plant, and equipment. Okay, so here we are looking at the higher turnover, the better. Okay, in terms of fixed assets turnover, the higher, the better. Okay, now total assets turnover. It measures how efficiently the company is deploying the totality of its resources to generate revenues. Now, this is the overall total assets. So net sales divided by average total assets. So here in total assets turnover, the higher the turnover, the better, because it implies effective use of assets to generate sales. Okay, so it's always less than the fixed asset turnover due to higher denominator. Okay, so that's it for today. I hope you learned, and our next topic will be profitability ratio. Okay, so but before I go on, please, please do subscribe. Click the subscribe button and share it with your families and friends if you've learned something with this video lesson. Thank you so much and mabuhay po kayo.